And first and foremost, on behalf of the organizers, I'd like to apologize for the delay. A very good evening to each and every one of you who have joined us via Zoom. A warm welcome to today's panel discussion on the role of mothers in leadership, balancing work, family, and life, presented by the RPSL Consortium. At this juncture, it is vital to speak a little bit about the RPSL Consortium, which emerged as a unifying force, bringing together a diverse spectrum of intellectuals, professionals, and community leaders. This powerful alliance, dedicated to fostering dialogue and understanding, aims to bridge the gaps between communities and also to rebuild the peace that was lost. Led by President, Senior Attorney at Law, Shabri Halimdin, who is also the Chairman for Muslim Reforms Committee and former Chairman of Wakuf Board of Sri Lanka, with the guidance of Founder, Vice President and Patron, Mr. Saif Hanifa, and Founder, Vice President, Mr. Wazir Mukhtar, the RPSL Consortium stands as a testament to the belief that a peaceful and prosperous Sri Lanka can definitely be achieved through collective effort, and that's what they're working on. And the organization is driven by a commitment to serving the community, envisioning a nation where all citizens live with peace and dignity, and working towards ambitious objectives for building a more inclusive and sustainable future for Sri Lanka. So now, to formally welcome each and every one of you who have joined us via Zoom, I'd like to invite Mrs. Shahnaz Hakim, the Board of Management Member and Deputy Secretary General of RPSL Consortium and Managing Director, Zaitun Industrial Projects Private Limited.
Thank you, Sharita. Good evening, everybody, ladies and gentlemen. So it's my privilege to give you the... It's my privilege to deliver the to welcome you, the President and distinguished members of the Board of Management, RPSL, respected panelists, and valued participants. It is my pleasure to welcome you to today's insightful panel discussion on the role of mothers as leaders, balancing work, family and life. We are gathered to explore the multifaceted roles of mothers play in our communities, workplaces and homes. Let me begin by mentioning that we were looking forward to the keynote address by the President of RPSL Consortium, Mr. Shabri Halimdin. However, we regret that he is not in a position to join us virtually as planned because he is traveling overseas. Nevertheless, we hope he can join us online, if time permits, at some point during the event. In our fast-paced world, balancing professional and personal responsibilities poses significant challenges, with mothers often leading the way in managing these delicate balances. Today, our panelists will delve into these challenges and share their experiences, insights, and strategies for succeeding as leaders while nurturing their families and themselves. I extend a warm welcome to our panelists, Ms. Oshadi Somasinghe Karunaratne, Ms. Nadika Damayanti, and Ms. Vanaja Selvaratnam, who will be joining us online, and Dr. Dilisha Pereira, who is here with us along with Ms. Oshadi, and Ms. Sharifa Tahir, our moderator. We are privileged to hear from each of you and are grateful to your contributions. I'm also happy to welcome Mr. Saif Hanifa, Founder, Patron and Vice President of RPSL Consortium, who is with us on site, motivating our team and personally ensuring the success of this event. Thank you to all of you in attendance today, whether here in person or virtually. Your interest and engagement makes events like this possible and impactful. As we begin this conversation, I encourage reflection on the unique journey and leadership styles exemplified by mothers everywhere. Let us celebrate their resilience, creativity, and dedication to making a difference in both their professional and personal lives. May it enlighten and inspire everyone, all mothers and leaders. Thank you.
Very much, Mrs. Hakim, and that was certainly an insight as to what we have in store for you today. And it's time for us to commence the panel discussion on role of mothers in leadership, balancing work, family and life, presented by the RPSL Consortium. And before we commence, I'd also like to bring to your notice that towards the latter part of the panel discussion, we will also have a Q&A session, so you can drop your questions to the chat box, and depending on the time, we will certainly respond to each and every one of your questions. And you can also mention the panelists you want to post the question at. And to begin with, let me introduce our panelists to you. And initially, I'd like to welcome Ms. Oshadi Somasingha Karunaratne, who is the Head of Product Development and Branding, Imperial Tea Exports Private Limited. She began her educational journey in Zambia, gained a solid foundation in English, leading to a passion for creative writing and music. And she also has a business degree from Staffordshire University, UK, and professionally qualified in marketing, including digital marketing and branding. And she's also currently the youngest member of the Board of Women's Chamber of Industry and Commerce. A warm welcome to the panel discussion. And I'd also like to introduce you to our next panelist, who is joining us via Zoom right now. And we have with us Mrs. Nadika Damayanti. She's the Assistant Municipal Commissioner, Kalaba Municipal Council, seasoned local government professional with over a decade of experience in various administrative roles, Municipal Secretary and Assistant Commissioner, Kalaba Municipal Council, and also the Deputy Director, Land Management and Development, Kalaba Municipal Council, Assistant Secretary, Department of Sports Development to the Ministry of Sports, Management Assistant, Divisional Secretariat, Ambilipitiya and Kahavata. And she's also having an expertise in municipal administration, land development, sports development, and local government operations. And so she's joining us virtually today, and we're honored to have you with us today. And I'd also like to introduce our next panelist, who is with us, Dr. Delisha Pereira. She is the co-founder chairperson, La Vivente Private Limited and Dilchand Private Limited. And she's also recognized as Asia's top outstanding women marketer of the year 2022, first Sri Lankan woman to receive an award under this category by the Asian Marketing Federation. In 2023, she was also recognized as one of the most admired marketing leaders by the World Marketing Congress in Mumbai and Best Entrepreneur of South Asia under the SME category at the South Asian Partnership Summit. And she's also at a Business Excellence Awards 2023 held on the November 30th, 2023 in Male, Maldives. And we are honored to have you with us today as well.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Doctor. And I'd also like to introduce you to our next panelist, who is joining us today via Zoom, and that is virtually. She is Ms. Vanaja Selvaratnam. We are honored to have you with us, Ms. Vanaja, who is the Provincial Director, Department of Industries, and has a Master's in Public Administration, University of Sri Jayawardenepura, Bachelor of Arts, University of Jaffna in 2003, Provincial Director, Department of Industries, Northern Province, 2020 to present, Assistant Director, Department of Social Services, Assistant Chief Secretary, Department of Cultural Affairs, Chief Secretariat, Secretary Secretariat, Northern Province, and Assistant Secretary, Provincial Public Service Commission, Assistant Land Commissioner, Department of Land of Eastern Province, and also recognized as Successful Executive Woman Leader by the University of Jaffna this year. So we are honored to have you here with us, Ms. Vanaja Selvaratnam. Thank you so much for joining us in this panel discussion. And last but not the least, let me introduce you to a panelist who is here, Ms. Shanaz Hakim, Managing Director, Zaitun Industrial Projects Private Limited, entrepreneur with four decades of experience in the dairy and confectionery industry, as a diploma in food science and technology, Sri Lanka, executive diploma in business administration, Faculty of Graduate Studies, University of Colombo, Master of Business Administration, Faculty of Finance and Management, Doctoral Researcher in Business Administration, Faculty of Management and Finance, University of Colombo, past chairperson, Lanka Confectionery Manufacturers Association, past president, Association of Muslim Women Professionals and Entrepreneurs, graduate of the Sri Lanka Institute of Directors, Women Entrepreneur of the Year 2011 Bronze Large Category, and she also has a Business Excellence Entrepreneurial Award 2024 All Ceylon Women's Association. And a warm welcome to Ms. Shahnaz Hakim as well. We are honored to have such an amazing panel, a very diverse panel, who will be talking about a very timely topic. As we mentioned, it's about balancing work, family, and life. This is something which we could talk for days, but I think at this juncture, it's vital to focus on some of the experiences you have faced which could shape the future generation as well. So first and foremost, I'm going to focus my attention to Ms. Oshadi. And I understand that you have been studying overseas, that is in Zambia. In our introduction, we did mention that. So from Zambia to Sri Lanka, obviously it was a journey already. So tell us a little bit about your experience in marketing, which has exposed you to diverse cultures already. And how has this global perspective, because living in Sri Lanka, living abroad is different. So how has this global perspective helped you balance your career with your role as a mother?
So thank you for that question. So the answer is actually in your question itself. You know, when you're exposed to diverse cultures, I think for me, from at a very early age of having to be exposed to those different cultures and seeing how the role of a woman or a mother in that context and how they've had to deal with everything, how they've had to manage everything. So for me personally, since I grew up in a foreign country as a foreigner, as an expatriate, it was very different for my family because we moved overseas and my father was working full-time, so my mother actually had to take on the full role. So it was a completely unknown territory, and she is my biggest role model. So she had to, you know, adapt, and she came from a very conservative background. So for her to go into a totally different world and then adapt and adjust and grow and, you know, take on the responsibility of raising us while my father was doing his job, so that itself was the experience that I had. And then, you know, just in general, because when I went to school and I went to a trust school, so I was anyway exposed to a lot of different individuals from different countries. So I saw how the mothers, my friends, my peers, you know, how their mothers were, how those women were, you know, basically carrying on with their responsibilities. And then progressing into my career in international marketing, again, I got exposed to diverse cultures. So I'm very familiar. I think itself, it was instilled that there's endless possibilities for women. You can see the amount of potential that women have and their capabilities and basically how women are very capable in adapting to all kinds of cultures. So for me, it was instilled from the very early stages that a woman can do anything and the sky is the limit. So for me, that is how it has helped.
Yes, Oshadi, as you did mention, things start at home. And you had a very good background as to, you know, a promising mom who has been helping you and also proving things to you. So you understand that a woman can play a major role. And obviously that is in your blood and in your system, which you've grown into. And we talk more about your experience in the private sector in Sri Lanka as well, because you're heading a private company, so obviously that's a lot of work, and being a mother. So what's special about today's panel discussion is that all our panelists are mothers, and they're also involved in very important roles outside of their home as well. So it's like you have a role outside, you have a role inside. So today's discussion would focus mainly on that. So from Oshadi, I'm going to shift to our panelist who has joined us virtually. That is Ms. Damayanti. Ms. Damayanti, can you hear me? Ms. Damayanti? Yes, Ms. Damayanti, my question to you would be, since you're working in the government sector, so that brings unique challenges that might, you know, people might not even realize what you face. So how do you balance these demands with your role as a mother? So in Sinhalese, we'd prefer that, Ms. Damayanti.
Sri Lanka Public Service mostly based on service orientation, and it is must to adhere to the rules and regulations while performing our duties. As example, the Constitution, Civil Law, Public Administration Circulars, Treasury Circulars, and Internal Circulars can be mentioned. A broad acknowledge over them are very essential while performing our duties. As you know, the government institutions directly deal with the public. So there's a huge responsibility assigned on the government organizations over formulating and implementing government policies. A wide range of services are provided by the government agencies. In my experience, each and every day of a government officer is a challenging day. I think it's same over the private sector as well. So today I would like to share my past achievement with young generation. I lived in Amblypettiya, one of the most challenging areas in the Ratnapura district, where I worked as a management assistant service from 2001 to 2012. Then my future goal was to be promoted an executive level position in administrative service. So I dedicated myself to create the necessary foundation. I attended seminars for a year in Colombo, and it's that was already 170 kilometers far away from my hometown to Colombo. Then I gathered the required resources and did self-study for another year. During that time, I had 3 babies, and it was their most playful age. I used various strategies to study without disturbing them. While giving my children their favorite things, I made time for my studies. I used time when they were watching their favorite cartoons, or when they are sleeping, or when they are playing. I theft the time to focus on my education. So as well, I never offer my children fast food. As a mother, I prepared nutritious meals for them. After all of my hard works, I faced competitive examination for the selected SLS service. As well, I achieved the expected results, which changed everything of our family, our status, our residence, and even my children's schools also. So what I want to say is, I managed to achieve all these things while fulfilling my responsibilities as a mother. And my family also helped in all these steps, even my parents, my sisters, and my husband. So I want to say that to the younger generation who watching this program, back then I did it with limited resources, but today you have every resources within your fingertips with the advancement of technology. So by now you can achieve your dream goals way easier than me. So never give up, and nothing is impossible if you work for your passion.
Definitely, definitely, Ms. Nadika Damayanti. And we will also touch on various topics in terms of balancing work and family. And also, Ms. Nadika very correctly mentioned that times have changed. And well, it was very difficult back in the days, but many things are at your fingertips right now. And things have become easier, but it doesn't mean that it's going to be really, really simple for the younger generation, and we are the only ones who have been struggling. So it's always good to talk through everyone's experience as mothers and as corporate people who have been leading organizations and winning awards, achieving a lot in life. So I'm going to shift my attention to Dr. Pereira. Dilisha, you've excelled in both banking and also entrepreneurship. As I mentioned, that everyone's leading a family life also with being a mother. You have been raising a family in terms of achieving all this. So how do you balance these demanding roles, and what strategies have worked best for you?
I would say time management. I plan my day and I allocate time according to the priority. So I basically try to stick to that plan every day on my daily task. And also I am very concerned about the boundaries. Like, you know, as a mother, as an entrepreneur, I have so many responsibilities. My child is busier than me. So I have to get involved in so many things. My office, managing my office, as well as managing the family and the kid. So I've set up boundaries for myself. Like, you know, I don't accept everything which is coming to me, like, you know, say for an example, the invitations, the social gathering and everything. Even my task, you know, I'm very concerned about planning my self. And also I have a good team whom I have developed over a period of time. So I believe in delegating the responsibilities. My top team is very responsible. And I really count on them, and I pass certain responsibilities to them so that I, you know, I can entrust them that they will deliver the task that I've given to them. So
but isn't it difficult to build that team?
Over a period of time, I have built it. So it's difficult to, you know, you have to invest time and you need to have a lot of patience to build that team. So once you build it up, it's easy to manage. So I have taken that risk, you know, that investment, and I've been doing that for last couple of years. So right now I have a very good team whom, you know, I can really rely on.
Now, so, since you mentioned about team, Doctor, I thought I'd just ask something like this, because we have a lot of young aspiring entrepreneurs who have joined our Zoom as well to kind of learn from you. So I think Ms. Damayanti very correctly mentioned that you should never give up. So you mentioned that it takes at least 2 to 3 years to build that. How did you hold it?
Well, it's tough. It's very tough. But you need to understand. You need to understand your team first. You have to identify people who are capable, who are not capable, and based on that, you need to groom people. You know, basically, you as a leader, you need to groom people. That's your responsibility. So if you rightfully, you know, if you correctly groom the team, then you are really rewarded after some time. So you need to have a lot of patience for that. You need to study them a lot. You need to understand them, and you need to give, and you know, you also need to see how you can get the best out of them. So that's how I have been, you know, my banking experience have been very helpful in terms of leading my business now, because I used to be a banker for 17 years. I used to work for Standard Chartered and HSBC, which is the best banks for you to get groomed as a leader. So those experiences have helped me to, you know, sort of develop my team right now. That's how I built the team. So with that, I have delegated certain responsibilities, coming back to my main question, certain responsibilities to my team, which I'm very much relying on them. And apart from that, I plan my leave ahead so that, you know, my family life, my leisure time will not be disturbed by my work, and my work is also will not get disturbed because of my absence. So that I have planned accordingly. So I always believe that if your team is happy, they will always deliver the best to you. And I try to make, you know, keep my family happy, my team happy, so that, you know, end of the day, I achieve my objectives.
So that's how I have balanced my work and work-life balance.
Exactly. I think, as you did mention, you need a lot of time management and you need a lot of focus and pre-planning.
Yes.
As you mentioned, because
yes.
if you don't plan your leave, if you don't plan anything,
yes.
I think there's going to be a small lag. From
yes, exactly.
At least, you know, it could
yes.
be your workplace or your home.
Yes.
Something will be affected.
Yes.
And I'm going to talk to Mrs. Hakim right now. So we've heard from three of our other panelists about how they've been balancing. So as a seasoned leader and an entrepreneur yourself, how have you balanced the demands of leadership with personal right. responsibilities throughout your career?
Yeah, thank you for having me on the discussion, Sharifa. I'm actually in a way behind generation from these two young ladies. But if I can take you back to how I started and the experience I have had, but of course down the line things have been changing. But way back then, my father was an entrepreneur himself. So I really was inspired by him. But I come from a conservative background. So it was a question of not going out to work and so on, you know. So therefore, I actually really showed some interest in entrepreneurial ventures that he had undertaken. And I got involved with this, particularly this business. We started it in a small way. That was way back in 1983. So I've been working that, this was before I married. And so I worked hard, I enjoyed my work. It was challenging, but it was something new and I was very keen to be involved in that and to take it forward. Because I had a lot of support from my father, from my mother. They all had a lot of faith, unusually enough. They all had a lot of, unusually I say, because it's not easy to get the support of the family sometimes because they look at how you're going to balance your time and so on. So they look at that also. But they all readily gave me their support, including even my an aunt and a cousin who was very close to me, and she is now overseas. And my aunt is no more, but they were all involved in helping me. And my mother, after I married, my mother was always available. And I must say I was very blessed because I got a partner who's equally excited about this this venture and this enterprise, and he encouraged me and spent a lot of time with me and helped me to promote the business and to develop it and so on, because it was more or less a little beyond its infancy but needed developing. So in that way I was very fortunate, because I had such a lot of support systems, and he gave me a lot of tremendous support. He was there for my first daughter. I have two daughters. He was there for my first daughter, hands on. Also, whilst he was continuing his professional career, of course. But of course, by the time my second daughter was born, 5 years later, 6 years later, he didn't have that amount of time to spend. But in short, what I'm saying is that the support system is very, very, very essential, and that helped me a lot. I had virtually an extended family, but I think now it is different, perhaps, because of the nuclear families and so on. So I think that was a tremendous leg up for me, that they were available to help me out.
And you did mention that it all started in the 80s, and
yes.
times have definitely changed now.
Of course.
And I would also like to know now, I mean, there are so many youngsters who are tuned in today as well to learn from you. So getting support from family plays a pivotal role.
Of course.
And it doesn't work for everyone.
Exactly.
Because every block doesn't fit in sometimes.
Yes.
So somewhere you might, you know, need some support from some end. So obviously there are the women to help them out as well. There are people at home who would support them from some end. But now times have changed, and even transport system has evolved over
yes.
time. So what would you like to tell the young generation coming from a conservative family and getting the support system? I'm pretty sure there are people who are on the same boat as you are. So what would you like to tell them as if they want to be an entrepreneur? Now they are aspiring to be one. So how could they approach their parents?
Of course, it will be wonderful if they have the support, but it's always good to have, if not a very extended support system, but at least those within your children, if they are old enough, if they're too young, they won't understand. But certainly I would say your partner, your spouse actually, has to cooperate, because otherwise it's very difficult to balance both, you know. Of course, even if you're left with more parenting duties because they are unable to maybe focus so much on the family due to their duties and responsibilities, nevertheless, they are cooperation, so to say, or his blessings and his assistance should always be there. That is there. So that is one thing that I would ask, that they first co-opt them in their ventures. That is one. Then the other thing is to work hard, and be consistent. Whatever you do, to work hard and be consistent. Sometimes you can't expect things to change very quickly. So everything is sometimes incremental, not exponential. So they have to learn to, you know, to change, to go with the flow, and to never take a step back. They ought to be able to quickly adapt, because now, unlike the time when I was involved and then, you know, going forward in my business, it's about 40 years ago. At that time, things were moved slowly, and there was not so much of what shall I say, dynamics in the environment and so on. It was more stable and so on. But now it's not the same, and the pressures are much, much more, much higher.
And every industry is competitive.
Every industry is competitive. So you need to, as an entrepreneur, I would say, I would encourage all these young people, as many young people with the talent and the skill and the calling, to come into the to join as entrepreneurs, because we, as everybody says and everybody knows, the SME is very, very, very is carrying the bulk of the economic output in this country. So they need you need entrepreneurs to support that system. So I think we ought to encourage them, whether they are younger or, of course, as I mean, they are mothers, it becomes even more difficult. I understand that, but I would say a support system, work hard. Don't expect changes overnight, but continue your education. One other thing, take care of yourself. You know, sometimes you dedicate yourself totally and then you forget yourself, but you need to care for your health, so that it keeps you happy mentally and so on. So those are the things that I see which the young people can do. And of course, Dr. Deisha was saying there's a lot of technology now. So, and also there's the possibility of flexible working arrangements and so many things.
Definitely. And yeah. I mentioned that times have changed and that you started your entrepreneurial journey way back, and it's almost been 40 years. So as a mother, how have you adopted this change in technology, and also how have you kind of shown it on your kids?
Well, I think the kids, right from the beginning, they accepted this. I think most of the time my mom was available for them. But of course I was also available hands-on. I didn't neglect them, because I have two girls. So I didn't neglect them. At least I tried my level best, and I think it has been successful. So I was there for them. I mean, you need to go to school and you need to meet their, you know, parent PTA meetings, this and that. So I was hands-on for all that, despite everything. But I must also say that I had a little bit of flexibility, because it was my own enterprise, and I, so to say, actually the family, it's a family business, and I have a family on the board of directors. So I had all that help, but I didn't allow this to affect the children. I didn't stay away too long from them and so on. So I believe it has grounded them. That's what I wanted, to ground them. And assist them to come up. And they accepted that mom is busy, she's doing this, she's going to come back at the end of the day, and you know, but they were happy, they adjusted.
Definitely.
Yeah.
So we will also talk more about helping the next generation and also some advice from you later on.
Yeah.
But we do have Ms. Vanaja who is joining us online. And Ms. Vanaja, I'd like to pose my next question to you. With your deep experience in public administration, especially in the Northern Province, how do you handle the pressures of the government work alongside your responsibilities as a mother as well? And Ms. Vanaja, if you could respond to us in Tamil, it would be great. And also, please do switch on a video as well.
Thank to the RPSL to having this opportunity from Northern Province as a leader or as a mother. I am blessed. I am the lucky to have my family because they are my inspirations. Because my mother as an entrepreneur from 1991 to 1998, she was as a tailor. From that period, I am inspired from my mother. That is the first inspiration for me. And actually, I got government job in 19 years old. Now I have completed 25 years experience in the public administration. From that period, actually, I had a good experience. I had so many challenges, but I never think about that as the challenges. That's my one of the development of my career, I have started my career job in 1991 as a management assistant. From that period, already Nadika said, we have to follow some rules and regulations in the government sector. Anyhow, we have to follow that rules and regulation. We have to work in the service-oriented minded. That is one of the good thing for the public administration. As a mother, as a leader, we have to work as a teamwork. We have to work as a team. That is one of the good thing. Another thing, I have selected for the Sri Lanka Administrative Service in 2008. I was appointed to the Eastern Province. At the time, actually, I don't have any relationship or any friends in the Eastern Province. At the time also, I have managed my family with my one and only son. We never faced any problem as a leader because we have followed some techniques and we have followed some components to have some difficulties at the time. As you all know, in the Northern and Eastern Province, we faced there so many problems in that war period, 13 years war period. At that time also, we had adjust our life. That is also one of the things. Maybe for our achievement and other thing as a leader or as a mother. I already told my mother as one of the entrepreneurs at that time, we were unable to get the food items or all the things at that time. She was doing the tailoring and she was looking after, we are three daughters for my family. So she was looking after very well.
This certainly is very inspiring, and we'd like to hear your story in Tamil as well.
Okay, no problem. Okay, உண்மையில் நாங்கள் கடந்த காலங்களில் நாங்கள் பட்ட பல அனுபவங்கள் எங்களுடைய வாழ்க்கையிலே நாங்கள் முன்னேறுவதற்கு, அதாவது எங்களுடைய வாழ்க்கையை நாங்கள் இன்னும் முன்னேற்ற வேண்டும் என்கின்ற அந்த கடின உழைப்பிற்கு அவர்கள் அதுவும் ஒரு காரணமாக இருக்கலாம். அதை விட உண்மையில் எனது தாய் தந்தையரிடம் இருந்து நான் கற்ற பல நல்ல பண்புகள், உதாரணமாக எனது தாய் ஒரு சிறந்த தொழில் முயற்சியாளராக இருந்திருக்கின்றார். உண்மையிலே நான் அது ஒரு ஸ்ரீலங்கா அட்மினிஸ்ட்ரேட்டிவ் சர்வீஸ் ஆபீசராக வந்த பின்னர்தான் அதை நான் உணர்ந்து கொண்டேன். அதை விட எனது தந்தையரிடமிருந்து நான் பெற்ற சில நல்ல பண்புகள், நேர்மை என்பது, டைம் மேனேஜ்மெண்ட், அதாவது நேர முகாமைத்துவம் என்பது உண்மையில் நாங்கள் எனது குடும்பத்தின் வழியாக நாங்கள் பெற்றுக்கொண்ட விடயங்கள். அதனை விட உண்மையில் நான் என்னுடைய அந்த உமன் எம்பவர்மெண்ட் என்பது உண்மையில் எனக்கு ஆரம்பிக்கப்படுகின்றது 2004 நான் திடீரென எனது தாயாரை இழந்து விட்டேன். என்னுடைய வயது 24 அப்பொழுது. உண்மையில் அந்த நேரத்தில் எனது மூத்த சகோதரி, இளைய சகோதரி, நான் நடுவில் மூத்த சகோதரி சுவிஸில் வாழ்ந்து கொண்டிருக்கின்றபடியால் உண்மையில் எனது தந்தையாரையும் தங்கையையும் நான் பராமரிக்க வேண்டிய ஒரு நிலையில் சிறு வயதிலே இருந்ததும் ஒரு எனது அந்த தலைமைத்துவத்திற்கு ஒரு காரணமாக இருக்கலாம் என நான் பின்னரான ஏற்பட்ட காலங்களில் நான் அதை உணர்ந்து கொண்டேன். ஏனெனில் திடீரென எமது அம்மாவினுடைய மறைவு என்பது உண்மையில் எங்களுக்கு ஏற்பட்ட ஒரு பெரிய இழப்பாக இருந்தது. ஆனாலும் அந்த காலகட்டத்திலே உண்மையிலே நாங்கள் கல்வியிலே முன்னேற வேண்டும் என்பது நான் நினைக்கிறேன். நான் ஏலெவல் படிக்கின்ற காலம் வரைக்குமே நாங்கள் மின்சாரத்தில் படிக்கவில்லை. பாடசாலைக்கு கூட நாங்கள் நடந்து செல்கின்ற தன்மை இருந்தது. ஏலெவல் படித்த பின்னர் தான் நான் எனது கிராமத்திலே இருக்கின்ற ஒரு பாடசாலையில், எனது கிராமத்தில் இருக்கின்ற தனியார் கல்வி நிலையத்திலே மட்டுமே படித்து பல்கலைக்கழகத்திற்கு தெரிவாகி இருக்கிறேன் என்பதிலே நான் இற்ற வரைக்குமே பெருமை கொள்கின்ற விடயம். ஏனெனில் உண்மையிலே அது எங்களுடைய அந்த நாங்கள் மேலே முன்னேற வேண்டும் என்பதற்கான ஒரு சிறந்த ஒரு உத்வேகத்தை எங்களுக்கு அது தந்திருக்கின்றது என்றுதான் கூற வேண்டும். அதனை விட நான் என்னுடைய முதுகலை மாணி பட்டத்தை கற்கின்ற பொழுது என்னுடைய மகன் ஒரு வயதில் காணப்பட்டார். உண்மையில் இந்த உறவினர்களும் அற்ற நிலையிலே நான் திருவோணமலையில் இரவு 11 மணிக்கு பிறகு தான் என்னுடைய பாடங்களையே நான் கற்க தொடங்குவேன். உண்மையில் அது ஆங்கில மொழி மூலமான ஒரு கற்கையாக இருந்தபடியால் மிகவும் கடினமாக அதனை படிக்க வேண்டிய தேவைகள் இருந்தது. ஆயினும் அதனையும் முடித்து கொள்வதற்கு எனக்கு எங்களுடைய அந்த உழைப்பு என்பதற்கு அப்பால் நான் எங்களிடம் இருந்த அந்த தன்னம்பிக்கை, அவைதான் எங்களுடைய அந்த உத்வேகமானவற்றிற்கு காரணமாக அமைந்திருக்கலாம் என நினைக்கின்றேன். உண்மையிலேயே ஒரு அட்மினிஸ்ட்ரேஷன் ஃபீல்டிலே பல்வேறுபட்ட திணைக்களங்களிலே நான் கடமையாற்றுவதற்கான வாய்ப்புகள் இருந்திருக்கின்றது. ஸ்ரீலங்கா அட்மினிஸ்ட்ரேட்டிவ் சர்வீஸில் 17 வருடங்களை பூர்த்தியாகி இருக்கின்றேன். அதிலே சமூக சேவை திணைக்களும் எனக்கு நல்ல ஒரு விடயங்கள், அதாவது சமூக சேவை சார்ந்த விடயங்களை நாங்கள் எவ்வாறு மக்களுக்கு ஈட்டு கொடுக்க காட்டி கொடுக்க வேண்டும் என்பதற்கான நிறைய வாய்ப்புகளை அதில் எனக்கு தந்திருக்கிறது. தற்பொழுது தொழில்துறை திணைக்களத்தில் டிபார்ட்மெண்ட் ஆஃப் இண்டஸ்ட்ரீஸ் என்னுடைய வாழ்க்கை காலமாக இருக்கின்றது. உண்மையில் அதிலும் பல்வேறுபட்ட சிறு தொழில் முயற்சியாளர்களுக்கு நாங்கள் ஒரு மாதிரியாக அமைப்பதன் ஊடாக அவர்களை நாங்கள் முன்னேற்ற முடியும். பல்வேறுபட்ட பயிற்சிகளை நாங்கள் அவர்களுக்கு வழங்கி கொண்டிருக்கின்றோம். அதன் ஊடாக அவர்களை உண்மையில் நான் அவர்களுக்கு ஒரு கருத்துரைக்கின்ற பொழுது கூட அவர்கள் என்னுடைய ஒரு என்னுடைய கருத்துக்களை அவர்கள் எம்பவர்மெண்டாக எடுத்துக்கொள்கின்ற பல சந்தர்ப்பங்கள் இருக்கின்றது. ஏனால் அவர்கள் நாங்கள் எந்த பாதைகளை கடின பாதைகளை கடந்து வந்தோமோ கட்டாயம் முக்கியமானதாக காணப்படுகின்றது.
Yes, Ms. Vanaja has been taking us through her life experiences, and it has definitely been very inspiring for her to mention about how she had lost her mother at a very young age, and her sister was also residing overseas, and apparently she had to take care of her younger siblings all by herself with the support of her sister. And then while she was schooling as well, there was no electricity, and transport was difficult, walking to school, studying at late hours, looking after siblings, and then also later on giving birth to a son, then looking after her son and working, studying in English language, which was also quite a task. And this certainly is very inspiring for everybody out there, because things are quite easier now. Technology, access to information is just a tap away. And I think Ms. Vanaja's story would certainly definitely inspire many out there, because life is difficult back then and now things are a little bit more convenient. I will not say it's easy, but it's a little bit more convenient than it used to be. So that certainly would inspire many who are aspiring to be entrepreneurs to kind of try out if they're feeling a little scared too. And Ms. Vanaja, we will be getting back to you, and I'd like to talk to Oshidi. And as a mother and also a business leader, how do you promote work-life balance in your company?
In the company?
Yes.
So I think lead by example is the fundamental thing, because when you want to encourage women in the organization to see the potential of being able to have a career as well as a family, I think it's definitely important to lead by example. And how I do that was already pretty much covered by the other two panelists here, you know, with the time management and the prioritization. For me, of course, I have three very young kids. My kids are 5 and under, so I have 3 daughters, and so there itself it's very demanding, because I not only work in the company, but I also am attached to the Women's Chamber, so I do a lot of voluntary work there. There's a lot
and
of
the youngest member.
Yes, I'm the youngest member as well, and so there's a lot of responsibilities there as well, because I have the visibility pillar of the chamber as well. So it's a really about time management and balancing it. And so in essence, I mean, since it was already covered, but I make it a point to when I'm at work. So if I'm at work, then I'm giving work my 100%. If I'm doing work for the chamber, which is usually after my working hours, and so I spend about an hour and a half or so.
It's not like a 9-to-5 job for you.
It's not a 9-to-5. It's basically a 24/7 job. So, but whenever I'm with my kids or when I'm with my family, so I've had to make certain compromises where I don't take work home. I have a strict policy now. I do not work when I go home. And when I get home, it's like a switch. You know, I turn on and I'm mommy at home and I'm with my kids. So when I wake up in the morning, it's with them before I head out to work. Then 8 to 5, I work. Then I do my chamber work. And then when I head home, it's just kids, bedtime, reading a book. They get my full attention. And I've also, in my work life, I've kind of taken off a lot of weekend activities. I mean, I use it to spend time with my family. So I don't really try to get involved in a lot of professional work. There have been instances where I've had to, but like I said, it's about prioritization and, you know, picking and choosing what you let go. So for me, to answer your question, it's leading by example, and that is what I do. So whoever works with me, my peers, my subordinates, that's what they see. So they see me dealing with all of these things and balancing it out, and that's the kind of inspiration that I want to give them.
Definitely. And Oshidi, since you're a mother who is working, you mentioned about how you switch it off and then you're like a completely different person at home. You're the mom. And then again, at the chambers, you attend to the work with the chambers, attached to the chambers. So Oshidi, what about the people or the staff, the other mothers working in your company? What kind of support system do you have for them?
So we encourage, in our company, we encourage flexi work hours. We do allow that. And even when you're on maternity leave now, we've sometimes extended that. So if it's not, you're not limited to the 84 days, you know, you can stay a little longer. And so there have been instances where certain employees have had children who need a little bit of extra attention or special needs. And so we've compromised and we've adjusted our policies and our principles to support them. I think for me personally, I get a lot of support from my organization, because being a part of another organization and supporting that organization now, and you get appointed for trainees and programs, so you need to be given that time also. So that understanding from the management itself is very important. So I think from the top level itself, we've kind of encouraged our employees to be involved in a lot of things, to be actively involved in external things and develop themselves as well. So very supportive for women. I think we are looking at, you know, future opportunities of setting up creches. So when they have newborns, they are able to bring people to work. So we've looked at those potentials. I mean, some organizations already have this, but in our organization, we're looking at, you know, flexibility and, you know, how to support women more.
Interesting. And I think that would open up more women who are interested in carrying on their corporate life to continue. And we did hear from two panelists who are working in the government sector and about the pressure they have in terms of balancing their work at the institution and also having leading positions there, and how leadership role plays a major part in what they do in terms of balancing time management. So speaking of leadership, Doctor, you are an entrepreneur, and you mentioned that for 17 years you've been in the banking sector, and you've learned teamwork, you've learned how to kind of manage time and create your own team. So I would also like to know from you, as somebody who is heading to co-founding two companies, which is not easy, and then recruiting staff, what is the kind of environment you have for your staff, who are ladies, who are also mothers? What kind of support system do you have for them?
Yeah, given the nature of our business, it's a more women-driven nature of business. So we have young mothers, rather like elderly people. So, you know, my team is from about 18 to about 60. So especially for young mothers, we have, because we have online now, we've given opportunities for them to work from home, who's dealing with customers. So they are working remotely. So they work from home. And also we've given certain people flexi hours, certain roles, because we have to now, there are certain roles where we need people coming into office. And there are certain roles where they can work remotely as well as on flexi hours. So we have identified certain roles. So we've given that opportunity to people, to the ladies to have flexi hours. And also, as a policy, as Oshidi very correctly said, I also lead by example. When I'm in office, I really focus on office work, not my personal matters. They also know that I don't take personal calls, nothing. I really focus on my productivity. And then when I go home, I switch on my mom's role. So it's how that's how it works. And also, I also promote that in my team. So whenever they go on leave after office hours, I don't disturb them. And especially my top team, I really don't disturb them. You know, they need to have their personal life. And they need to, you know, sort of come out with, you know, relieve that stress and be with their family and, you know, to enjoy that life. So I really believe in that. So I don't really disturb them. And also, I also don't encourage them to take any office work home and, you know, work after office hours. Even I don't do that. So, you know, certain things we've implemented where people are really happy with you know, the facilities that we have offered, and also we don't have official creche, but you know, when the mothers when they need to bring the kids, like when they don't have support from home, and when they are not, when the kids are not going to school, so they bring the kids to office. But they don't disturb office work. The kids also understand, they have come to the office environment, then they have seen what is going on. They don't disturb the productivity of the mother. They get together, they play, because we have a certain, like a area where they can play. So they play with each other. So they know each other, like, because
it's my like employees, a networking session for even the
exactly,
kids.
Exactly, because I have a team who is little long-standing people. Mm-hmm. They're with us for some time, so they know each other. The kids also know each other, so it doesn't really affect the office work, the productivity. I also really focus on the productivity in terms of not the hours, but the productivity. You know, when the certain tasks are given, if that is completed, then the employee is free to go. So certain things like that, certain things we've implemented, and that has been paid off well in our system. So that is the facilities that we have provided for our employees.
That certainly is, I think, a great move initiated by the ladies here, as I see. I definitely hope that there are so many heads of institutions and also organizations who are watching our lives, so that this could be something which could be a common thing, not a topic of discussion like we are doing right now, because we need to accommodate flexi hours and also look into the well-being of the family life as in general. It's not just about the lady, but also the gentleman. So I think what you did mention is not very commonly found in every single institution, because certain organizations require their staff to work 8 hours, and then you have to be in the premises, and then it's not convenient for them to bring their kids in. So there are things like that also happening right now. So I guess this is kind of like an inspiration to many out there who can possibly think of, you know, accommodating all this into their workplaces as well. So I'm going to also talk to Ms. Damayanti right now, since we've been talking to people from the private sector, and I'd like to shift to the government sector now. In your experience as an assistant municipal commissioner, what are some of the toughest challenges you face balancing work in the public sector with the family life, and how have you overcome them? And I'd like to hear from you in Sinhalese as well.
Mama Kolamba Mahanagara Sabhave Nagarika Lekam Wagema Sahakara Nagarika Commissaris kiyana tanaturu dekema me kala seemave rajakari karanawa. ඇත්තටම මගේ සෑම දවසක්ම මවක් විදිහට වගේම රාජ්‍ය සේවයේ විධායක නිලධාරිනියක් විදිහට මට අභියෝගාත්මක දවසක්. කොළඹ මහනගර සභාව සභා සීමාවේ නගරවාසීන් ආසන්න වශයෙන් 106කට ආසන්න ජනතාවක් ඉන්නවා. ඒ වගේම දෛනික අවශ්‍යතා සපුරා ගන්න දුරබැහැර ප්‍රදේශවලින් දෛනිකව තවත් 106කට ආසන්න ජනතාවක් කොළඹ නගරයට පැමිණෙනවා. ලංකාවේ තියෙන ප්‍රධානතම පළාත් පාලන ආයතනයේ විදිහට කොළඹ මහනගර සභාවට විශේෂ වගකීමක් පැවරෙනවා. මේ සියලුම ජනගහණයට කොළඹ නගරයට දෛනිකව පැමිණෙන ජනතාවට අවශ්‍ය අඩිතල පහසුකම් සපයන. මෙහිදී කොළඹ මහනගර සභාවේ ප්‍රධාන තනතුරක් උසුලන අතරම මවක් විදිහට මම මගේ පවුලේ කටයුතු සමබරව පවත්වාගෙන යන මම මගේ සියලු වැඩ කටයුතු පූර්වයෙන් සැලසුම් කරනවා. මම දියණියන් දෙදෙනෙක්ගේ වගේම පුතෙකුගේ මවක්. ඉතින් මගේ පුතා මේ වන විට එයාගේ උපාධි අවසන් කරලා මෘදුකාංග ඉංජිනේරුවරයෙක් විදියට සේවය කරනවා. ඒ වගේම මගේ දියණියන් දෙදෙනා මේ වසරේ සාමාන්‍ය පෙළ සහ උසස් පෙළ විභාගයන් සඳහා පෙනී සිටීමට සූදානම් වෙනවා. මේ දිනවල මගේ නිවසේ තියෙන්නේ විභාග මූලික කරගත් පරිසරයක්. ඉතින් ඒ වගේම පැය 24 පුරා සේවයේ යෙදෙන රාජ්‍ය සේවයක තමයි මම සේවය කරන්නේ. එහිදී මට මගේ මොබයිල් ෆෝන් එක මේ පැය 24 පුරාම ඔන් කරලා තියන්න වෙනවා. විශේෂයෙන් පහුගිය කාල සීමාවේ කොළඹ නගර සීමාවේ ජීවත් වෙන අයට මේ සම්බන්ධ අත්දැකීම් ඇති. කාලගුණික විපර්යාසයන් වලට අපි මුහුණ දීලා තියෙනවා. මේ සිදුවන කාලගුණික වෙනස් වීම අනුව විවිධ ස්වභාවික අනතුරු ගස් කඩා වැටීම්, කෙටි වැස්සකටත් මාර්ග යටවීම් වැනි ස්වභාවික අනතුරු වලට අපිට මුහුණ දෙන්න වෙලා තියෙනවා කොළඹ නගරේ. ඉතින් මේ වගේ වෙලාවල් වල ක්ෂණිකව මේ දේවල් වලට ඇටෙන්ඩ් වෙලා අදාළ නිලධාරීන්ට අවශ්‍ය නියෝග දීලා මේ තියෙන බාධාවන් ඉවත් කරලා මාර්ග අවහිරතා ඉවත් කරලා සාමාන්‍ය ජන ජීවිතයට ඉඩ පහසුකම් සලසන්න විශේෂ වූ වගකීම් සම්භාරයක් මා වෙත පැවරිලා තියෙනවා. මෙහිදී විශේෂයෙන්ම මට තියෙන අභියෝගයක් තමයි එදිනෙදා දෛනික රාජකාරී කරනවා වගේම කොළඹ නගර මහනගර සභාවට පැමිණෙනවා නගරවාසීන් ඔවුන්ගේ ප්‍රශ්න ගැටලු විසඳා ගන්න. මේ මහජනතාවට ආමන්ත්‍රණය කරන එක, ඔවුන්ගේ ප්‍රශ්න හඳුනාගෙන ඔවුන්ට ඒ සඳහා විසඳුම් ලබා දෙන එක මට අභියෝගයක්. මේදී හැම වෙලාවෙම මම උත්සාහ කරනවා මගේ අභ්‍යන්තර වටිනාකම් සහ මගේ කුසලතා උපයෝගී කරගෙන මේ සියලු ගැටලු වලට මට හැකියාකාරයට ධනාත්මකව බලලා විසඳුම් දෙන්න. ඇත්තටම මම හොඳ සවන් දෙන්නෙක් විදිහට මම දකිනවා. මහජනතාවගේ ප්‍රශ්න වලට මම හොඳින් සවන් දෙනවා. ඒ තුලින් ඔවුන්ට විශ්වාසයක් ඇති වෙනවා මේ ප්‍රශ්න වලට මට විසඳුමක් ලබා දෙන්න බැරි වුණත් ඔවුන්ගේ ප්‍රශ්න වලින් 50%ක් විසඳෙනවා මම ඔවුන්ට සවන් දීම තුල. ඉතින් මේ විදිහට අභියෝගාත්මක රාජ්‍ය සේවයක් නියුතු වෙලා ඉන්න මවක් විදිහට මම සතියන්තයේදී මගේ ඉදිරි සතිය සැලසුම් කරනවා මගේ පවුලේ සමාජිකයන් එක්ක එකතු වෙලා. මගේ ඩ්‍රෙස් කෝඩ්ස්, ඒ වගේම සතියේ මීල්ස්, දරුවන්ගේ අමතර පන්ති, මේ සියලු දේවල් පිළිබඳව පවුලේ සියලු දෙනාම එකතු වෙලා සාකච්ඡා කරලා අපි සැලසුම් හදාගන්නවා. ඒ වගේම මවක් විදිහට මම මගේ පවුලේ සනීපාරක්ෂාව, ඒ වගේම පෝෂණය, මේ සියලු දේවල් පිළිබඳව අවධානය යොමු කරන්න ඕනි. ඒදී මම කෙටි ආහාරවලට ප්‍රමුඛතාවයක් දෙන්නේ නැහැ. විශේෂයෙන් මගේ පවුලට, මගේ දරුවන්ට මම හැම වෙලාවෙම උත්සාහ කරන්නේ පෝෂ්‍යදායී ආහාර වේලක් දෙන්න. ඒ වගේම මම දරුවන්ට විවෘත වූ මවක්. මගේ දරුවන්ට දැන් ඔවුන් නව යෝන් වියේ ඉන්න දරුවන්, ඉතින් ඔවුන්ට ඔවුන්ගේ හැඟීම් නිදහසේ මා සමග බෙදාගන්න පුළුවන් වාතාවරණයක් මම ඔවුන්ට හදලා දීලා තියෙනවා. මම හැම වෙලාවෙම උත්සාහ කරනවා ඔවුන්ට සවන් දීලා ඔවුන්ගේ ලයිෆ් ස්ටයිල් එක බැලන්ස් කරගන්න මට පුළුවන් උපරිම දායකත්වයක් දෙන්න. ඒ වගේම මගේ ගෙදර මගේ හස්බන්ඩ් ව්‍යාපාරික ක්ෂේත්‍රයේ නිරිලා ඉන්න කෙනෙක්. ඔහුත් බොහොම කාර්යබහුලයි. ඉතින් මගේ දරුවන්, මම ඇතුළු අපි පවුලේ සියලුම දෙනාම ඉන්න විවිධ ස්තරයන් අනුව විවිධ මට්ටමේ ස්ට්‍රෙස්, එහෙමත් නැත්නම් ආවේගයන් වල අපි හැමෝම ඉන්නවා. ඉතින් මේ සියලු දේවල් පාලනය කරගන්න අම්මා කෙනෙක් විදිහට මට නිවස තුල කරන්න පුළුවන් සියලුම දේ මම කරනවා. ඒ වගේම ඔවුන්ට හොඳින් සවන් දෙන, ඔවුන්ට අවශ්‍ය උපදෙස් සහයෝගය මවක් විදිහට විතරක් නෙමෙයි ඔවුන්ගේ මිතුරියක් විදිහට ඔවුන්ව තේරුම් ගන්න අවශ්‍ය සහයෝගය දෙන්න මම හැමතිස්සෙම උත්සාහ කරනවා. ඒ වගේම මම මගේ වැඩ පහසු කරගන්න විශේෂයෙන් මගේ ස්මාර්ට් ෆෝන් එක යූස් කරනවා. විවිධ මොබයිල් ඇප්ස් තියෙනවා දැන් අපිට මගේ කාර්යාලයේ වැඩ කටයුතු පහසු කරගන්න. වර්චුවල් මීටින්ස්, මොබයිල් ඇප්ස්, ඒ වගේ දේවල් පාවිච්චි කරනවා. එහිදී පෞද්ගලික වැඩ කටයුතු වලටත් මට ස්මාර්ට් ෆෝන් එක ගොඩක්ම උදව් වෙනවා. ඉතින් අද අපිත් එක්ක සම්බන්ධ වෙලා ඉන්න තරුණ කාන්තාවන්ට, එමත් නැත්තම් යූත් ජෙනරේෂන් එකට මට කියන්න තියෙන්නේ මවක් වීම රාජ්‍ය සේවයේ හෝ පෞද්ගලික සේවයේ නායකත්වයක් ඉසිලීමට, රටේ ප්‍රධාන වගකීම් දැරීමට කිසිසේත් බාධාවක් නෙමෙයි. කාන්තාවක් මවක් වීමේදී මම දකින්නේ ඇයට විශේෂ වූ ශක්තියක්, ආත්ම ශක්තියක් ලැබෙනවා ඇයගේ දරුවන් තුළින්. ඉතින් මේ දේවල් ශක්තියක් කරගෙන තමුන්ගේ අභ්‍යන්තර වටිනාකම්, හැකියාවන් හඳුනගෙන හොඳ ගමනක් යන්න කාන්තාවන් විදිහට ඔබට පුළුවන්. ඉතින් මම ආරාධනා කරන ඔබ සියලු දෙනාට මේකට සම්බන්ධ වෙලා ඉන්න ඔබ ඔබේ හැකියාවන් තේරුම් ගන්න, ඔබේ වටිනාකම් අවදි කරන්න, ඔබ සම්පූර්ණ ශක්තිය යොදවලා යම්කිසි ඉලක්කයක් කරා ළඟා වෙන්න උත්සාහ කරනකොට ඒ වෙනුවෙන් අරමුණු ගත වෙන්න. එහිදී කිසිවෙකුටත් ඔබව නවත අලිය නොහැකි ඔබට ඔබේ අරමුණු ඉලක්ක කරා ළඟාවීමට ඔබ සතු ශක්තිය සහයක් වෙනවා.
Bhumi Stuti, Dhamme Dhamme Aunty, for giving us a very beautiful insight into
it's actually completely different from what we heard from the corporates now being personalities who are heading institutions, companies, and also being the founder of two different companies as well. But I mean, you spoke about flexi hours, you spoke about how there's a mom time and also a switch to knock off and then focus on the kids. But from the government sector, we heard like a different perspective altogether because, I mean, the job you do and the role you play in that institution also comes into play when deciding how to balance your schedule as well. So she said that she needs to have her mobile on 24 hours because of the nature of the job she's doing. And obviously, you never know at which time of the day a natural disaster can happen. And I think she needs to be attentive to that as well. So that's actually very inspiring, Ms. Nadhika Damayanti. Thank you so much for taking us through the insight and details into how you manage your time, and being a good listener has played a very important role in her life, and also bringing up the children and listening to what they need and planning and organizing. And I do understand working in the government sector requires you to wear in a certain way. And I guess that also can really affect your time, and it's not easy to slip into a sari to get to work in the morning. So that involves a lot of work. But at the end of the day, what we need to understand as women is that if there's a passion, if there's a will, and if you have a good support system, I'm pretty sure that you could pursue in what you're doing. And being a mother is not a barrier. Being a mother is definitely not a barrier. So I'd also like to talk to Mrs. Hakim. And you're passionate about inspiring the next generation of women leaders. So how do you encourage women to take on leadership roles? And how has your experience shaped this?
Actually, first thing I need to ask them to adapt, to be prepared to adapt and change. This is very important because, you know, they need to focus on what they're doing, and then to have the patience to allow it to come to fruition, whatever they are planning to do or getting involved with. So, but they must not fear. Then they must continue their education, which is also very necessary. Of course, I had to stop my education partly when the children were growing, and then resume it after they grew older and so on. But what I'm telling them is to always be open to always be open to continuing their education, to leverage the technology, like both my friends here said. So you know, with the upcoming generation, technology is a very big thing. So they can leverage that for so many, you know, to work. To be time smart, time management, and so many things, which we didn't have in way back then.
It's all also, about writing down a notebook having a schedule, yes, or marking the calendar.
Exactly.
But now you have reminders.
You have reminders, you have everything. So that's also very helpful, you know. But also, now there were two sides to this coin. One is that I think Dr. Dilisha said that what she's talking about is to segregate.
Yes.
Home life and the work. But in my case, in my day, I had to integrate the two. Like Ms. Nadhika here said, that we were like so sort of on call, the business was just growing, my attention was needed, but also I had to balance it with the children and so on. So I couldn't segregate it altogether. But of course, I agree with her that that's an excellent way to go about it. Now, if I had the opportunity and I was starting now, perhaps I would do that. The other thing is, I would encourage these young people to not always focus just on, of course, what they're developing and what they're getting into. They need to focus on that, of course. But what I would encourage also is to build up a very big network, a support system. They can have peers, mentors, and then advisors. They can reach out because now everything is available. People are very flexible and so on. So I think that is very necessary because I have found networking and being mentored. I was also mentored by certain people to whom I'm still grateful, who are here, not with us now. sadly. But anyway, I have also been mentored, you know. So I went out there and I started engaging in social work or activities or whatever. So I'm encouraged, because that is also relaxing. You're building yourself up, you know. You're just, of course you have to work hard. Of course you have to do things to you know, focus on what you're bringing up. But also you need to enjoy your enjoy that, you know, work.
Yeah, you need to. You need to have a life too.
You need to have a life too. Exactly. That's what I'm trying to say. You said it in a nutshell. So I think that's also very important. Of course, perhaps like these young people in this that involved, they may not find the time to do that. Way back in my day, also that happened. But now, I still encourage them to take the time for self-care. And of course, both of them are spending time with their children anyway and so on. But the self-care and to develop yourself, whatever you can keep on doing. Both of them have a lot of potential. Also, do the other two ladies who joined us. So keep doing that. Keep positive. Keep positive and depend on your network. I, of course, still depend on my support system. And in our industry, we can't... I know there's a lot of flexi work that others... I mean, certain industries can do, so, but if it's a service industry, because I'm involved both in a manufacturing and a service industry, it's combined in the same business. So it's not always easy to do flexible working arrangements, even for me to stay home and work, which would be nice, but I cannot do it 100%.
Exactly, because it depends on the role you're playing. So someone coming from the media industry, I completely understand, because there's no other time. I read news except for 9 p.m. So I have to be there.
Exactly.
So nevertheless, it's all about, I guess, time management is what comes into play. And as our two other panelists who have joined virtually did mention about organizing and planning your schedule. And, you know, Ms. Nadika really very clearly mentioned that she always plans out her attire to the meal and everything else so that she could actually concentrate on her work, because it is like a 24-hour job which requires her attention when there's something urgent. So I guess it also depends on the path you select. So what you select is what you like. So definitely that's not going to be forced upon you. And if you understand the nature of the job and if you understand the nature of the path you've selected, I guess it's very easier to plan ahead and maybe work on it, because certain job roles, certain organizations require you to do things which you wouldn't like to do. But sometimes it's something you can't avoid as well. And since we did speak to Mrs. Hakim, I'd like to once again shift my attention to the government sector again. We do have a very diverse panel coming from different parts of the country as well, which is very important. So we have Ms. Vanaja from the Northern Province, and she did take us through life there, which has not been a very easy path. It has been rocky. And but nevertheless, she's in a very good position and somebody who could inspire people in that area. So Ms. Vanaja, I'd like you to answer this question in Tamil as well. As a recognized leader and also a mother, what personal strategies have helped you balance your demanding role in the Northern Province? That is with family life, and also you mentioned about many things you had to go through, which is certainly definitely inspiring for many out there. But I'm pretty sure that there are many in the Northern Province too who would like to learn from you. So speak us through that as well.
Sit okay? உண்மையில் அரச அலுவலகங்களை பொறுத்தவரையில் அது தனியார் நிறுவனங்களாக இருந்தாலும் கூட நேர முகாமைத்துவம் என்பது மிகவும் ஒரு ரூல்ஸாக காணப்பட்டாலும் கூட உண்மையிலே நாங்கள் எமது கீழ் இருக்கின்ற சபோர்டினேட்ஸ், அதாவது எங்களுக்கு கீழ் பணிபுரிபவர்களுடைய அந்த அவர்களுடைய நிலைமைகளை நாங்கள் கருத்தில் கொண்டு கடமையாற்ற வேண்டிய ஒரு தேவை காணப்படுகின்றது. உண்மையில் அவர்கள் எட்டரை தொடங்கி நாளை கால் வரைக்கும் அவர்களுடைய கடமையாக காணப்பட்டாலும் கூட சில பெண்களை பொறுத்தவரையில் அவர்கள் தங்களுடைய குடும்பங்களுடைய விடயங்களை செய்து வர வேண்டிய தேவை காணப்படுகின்ற பொழுது உண்மையில் அவர்களுடைய நிலைமைகளை நாங்கள் லிசன் பண்ண வேண்டிய ஒரு கடமை கட்டாயம் எங்களிடம் காணப்படுகிறது. அதாவது we have to listen them, otherwise we are unable to be as a leader, one of the strategy for the leaders, I think. And அதை விட உண்மையில் பாசிட்டிவ்னஸ், நாங்கள் எதையுமே நாங்கள் நேர்மறையான எண்ணங்களாக எடுக்கின்ற பொழுது அது எங்களுக்கு உண்மையில் அது ஒரு பாதிப்பான விடயமாக அமைந்தாலும் கூட அதை நாங்கள் நேர்மறையான எண்ணங்களாக எடுப்பதன் ஊடாக உண்மையில் சாதகமான பல விடயங்களை நாங்கள் சாதிக்கக்கூடிய அனுபவம் என்னிடம் காணப்பட்டிருக்கின்றது. அதனை விட உண்மையில் நாங்கள் இன்டகிரேட்டட் அப்ரோச், அதாவது பல திணைக்களங்களுடன் நாங்கள் இணைந்து செய்கின்ற பொழுது நாங்கள் அதில் சக்சஸ்ஃபுல்லான நிறைய விடயங்களை நாங்கள் கையாளக்கூடிய முறையாக காணப்பட்டிருந்தது. எல்லாவற்றையும் விட உண்மையில் அப்ரிசியேஷன் என்பது எங்களுடைய ஒவ்வொரு தலைவர்களிடம் காணப்பட வேண்டிய ஒரு விடயமாக காணப்படுகின்றது. உண்மையில் நான் சில திணைக்களங்களுடைய கடமையாற்றுகின்ற பொழுது மேலதிகாரிகளிடம் இருந்து அந்த பாராட்டுரை அல்லது மெச்சுரை என்பது நமக்கு கிடைக்கின்றது மிக மிக அரிதாக காணப்படுகின்றது. ஆகவே நான் எப்பொழுதும் அதற்கு அதை என்னது சபார்டினேட்ஸுக்கு, அதாவது என் கீழ் பணிபுரிபவர்களுக்கு நான் அதை தொடர்ந்தே செய்து கொண்டிருப்பேன். ஏனெனில் எங்களுக்குரியவர்கள் அதை செய்யாவிட்டாலும் கூட as a leader I have to do that. ஆகவே உண்மையில் அந்த அப்ரிசியேஷன் என்பது எங்களுடைய அந்த விடயங்களிலேயே முதலாவதாக காணப்படுகின்றது. இதையும் தாண்டி as a ஒரு அம்மாவாக, அதாவது as a mother, உண்மையில் எனக்கு ஒரே ஒரு மகனாக காணப்பட்டாலும் என்னுடைய நாளைக்குரிய விடயங்களை நான் முதல் நாளே நான் பிளான் பண்ணிடுவேன். உண்மையில் நான் காலை சமையலில் இருந்து மதிய சமையல் நான் போடுகின்ற உடையில் இருந்து மகனுடைய அனைத்து விடயங்களையுமே முதல் நாள் பிளான் பண்றது ஊடாக, அதாவது திட்டமிடல் என்பது கட்டாயம். ஒரு as a leader and as a mother, both sides we have to plan. ஒரு கூட்டமாக இருந்தாலும் கூட அதே நேரம் எங்களுடைய உணவு தயாரித்தலில் இருந்தாலும் அந்த பிளான் என்பது, திட்டமிடல் என்பது ஒரு முக்கியமான விடயமாக காணப்படுகின்றது. அதனையும் தாண்டி எங்களால் முடியும் என்கின்ற அந்த மன வைராக்கியம், அதாவது எங்களது கன்ஃபிடன்ட் வி ஹாவ் டு ஹேப். உண்மையில் நான் ஒரு ஐ ஆம் ஆல்சோ ஒன் ஆஃப் த என்டர்பிரினர், ஐ ஆம் சோ ஹாப்பி டு சே தட் ஒன். உண்மையில் நான் நாளை இந்த சாரியை நான் அணிய வேண்டும் என்று நினைத்தால் நான் அது முதல் நாள் இரவு நானே அதை தைத்துக் கொள்கின்ற அந்த என்னால் முடியும் என்கின்ற அந்த அந்த அது அந்த விடயம் உண்மையில் என் கீழ் பணிபுரிகின்றவர்களுக்கு அது ஒரு ஒரு அவர்கள் கூறுவார்கள், மேடம் ஒரு காலத்திலும் அயன் பண்ணாது அல்லது புது சாரி அணியாது வந்த காலம் கிடையாது. ஏனெனில் அந்த அவர்களுக்கு ஒரு மாடரேட்டராக அவர்களுக்கு ஒரு மென்டராக நான் இருந்திருக்கிறேன் என்பதில் நான் பெருமை கொள்கின்றேன். ஏனெனில் உண்மையில் நாங்கள் நினைக்கின்றோம், எதை நாங்கள் நினைக்கின்றோமோ அதுவாக ஆகின்றோம். நான் நினைக்கிறேன் உங்களுடைய தமிழ் எங்களுடைய வேதாந்தத்தில் இருக்கின்றது, நாம் எதை நினைக்கின்றோமோ நாங்கள் அதுவாக ஆகின்றோம் என்பது உண்மையில் நான் ஒரு ஸ்ரீலங்கா அட்மினிஸ்ட்ரேட்டிவ் சர்வீஸ் ஆபீசராக வர வேண்டும் என்பது என்னுடைய 22வது வயதிலே நான் ஒரு கூட்டத்திற்கு செல்கின்ற பொழுது ஒரு மேடம் ஒராளவா அவர் அந்த நேரம் ஒரு ஸ்ரீலங்கா அட்மினிஸ்ட்ரேட்டிவ் ஆபீசராக இருந்து அந்த கூட்டத்தை தலைமையேற்று நடாத்தி கொண்டிருந்தார். அந்த நாளிலிருந்து என்னிடம் ஒரு எண்ணம் உதித்தது, நான் அவாவாக வந்தால் எப்படி இருக்கும் என்கின்ற அந்த ஆசை அல்லது அந்த எண்ணம், அந்த அவா உண்மையில் என்னை ஒரு எஸ்எல்ஏஎஸ் ஆபீசராக இன்று வர வைத்திருக்கின்றது என்பதில் நான் மிகவும் திருப்தி அடைகின்றேன். ஏனெனும் உண்மையில் எங்களுடைய எண்ணம் சொல் செயல் எல்லாமே ஒன்றாகின்ற பொழுது கட்டாயம் நாங்கள் அதனை பெற்றுக்கொள்ள முடியும் என்கின்றது. அதனையும் விட உண்மையிலே பலர் என்னிடம் கேட்டிருக்கின்றார்கள், வீட்டில் கணவன் பிள்ளைகளை பராமரிப்பதற்கு எவ்வாறு உங்களால் முடிகின்றது, உண்மையில் அதற்கு நாங்கள் எவ்வாறு அவர்களுக்காக எங்களை விட்டுக் கொடுக்கின்றோமோ அதற்கு பல மடங்கு அவர்களிடம் இருந்து எங்களுக்கு பல சப்போர்ட்ஸ், அதாவது அவர்களிடம் இருந்து எங்களுக்கு ஒத்துழைப்புகள் கிடைக்கின்றது. உண்மையில் என்னுடைய வீட்டில் நான் எனது கணவருடைய தாயாரையும் பராமரித்து அவர் கடந்த வருடம்தான் உண்மையில் அவர் மரணம் அடைந்திருக்கின்றார். ஆகவே அதை அவர்களுக்கு வேண்டிய கடமைகளையும் செய்கின்ற பொழுது உண்மையில் எனக்கு நான் சில விடயங்களிலே உதாரணமாக கணவனுக்கு பிடித்த உணவு அல்லது மகனுக்கு பிடித்த உணவை செய்கின்ற பொழுது அவர்கள் எங்கள் மீதி இருக்கின்ற அந்த ஒத்துழைப்பு, அதை எங்களுக்காக அவர்கள் வழங்குகின்ற ஒத்துழைப்பு அன்பும் இரட்டிப்பாகின்றதுக்கான வாய்ப்புகள் இருக்கின்றதாகவே நாங்கள் சில விட்டு கொடுப்புகளை ஒரு வீதம் கொடுக்கின்ற பொழுது அவர்களிடம் வந்து 10 வீதமாக அல்லது பல மடங்குகளாக அந்த விட்டு கொடுப்புகள் எங்களை நோக்கி வருகின்றதாகவே இவை எங்களுடைய குடும்ப வாழ்க்கை சார்ந்த விடயங்களில் காணப்படுகின்றது போல உண்மை இது இப்படியான சில அப்ரோச்சஸை நாங்கள் அலுவலகங்களிலும், அதாவது ஒரு பிள்ளை பால் ஊட்டுகின்ற தாய் அலுவலகத்திற்கு வருகின்ற பொழுது சில வேளைகளில் மற்றவர்கள் 9 மணி கிட்டவாக வருகின்ற பொழுது உண்மையில் நாங்கள் அதனை கண்டிக்காது விடுகின்ற பொழுது, இன்னொரு சந்தர்ப்பத்தில் அவர்கள் மாலை நேரங்களிலே ஒரு அலுவலகத்தில் வேண்டிய தேவை ஏற்படுகின்ற பொழுது உண்மையில் அவர்கள் அதை மனமொத்து செய்கின்ற அந்த பக்குவம் அவர்களிடம் வளர்கின்றது. ஆகவே நாங்கள் சில கண்டிப்புகளையும் சில இதை அரவணைப்புகளையும் நாங்கள் சில அலுவலர்களிடம் காண்பிக்கிற பொழுது கட்டாயம் எங்களுக்கு அது ஒரு ஒரு பாசிட்டிவாக, அதாவது ஒரு நேர்மறையான விடயமாக எங்களை நோக்கி வருகின்றது. ஆகவே இது இரண்டு இது இவை எல்லாமே அப்ரோச்சஸ் சேம் இந்த ஃபேமிலி அண்ட் இந்த ஆபீஸ், பட் உண்மையில் அதை நாங்கள் இரண்டு ஒரே ஒரே விதமான அணுகுமுறைகளாக நாங்கள் பாவிக்கின்றோம். ஆனால் அவர்களிடமிருந்து பெற்றுக்கொள்கின்ற பெறுபவர்கள் எங்களுக்கு சரியானதாக அமைகின்றது. உண்மையில் என்னுடைய அலுவலகத்தை பொறுத்தவரையில் எல்லோருமே இன்முகத்துடன் சிரித்த முகத்துடன் கடமையாற்றுவதற்கு முதலில் நான் சிரித்த முகத்துடன் இருக்கின்றமை ஒரு முக்கியமான விடயமாக நான் நினைக்கிறேன். காலையில் நாங்கள் செல்கின்ற பொழுது எங்களுடைய அந்த ஹயராக்கி, அதாவது எங்களுடைய அந்த மேல்நிலைத்தன்மைகளை பார்க்காது நாங்கள் அவர்களை நோக்கி காலை வணக்கம் சொல்கின்ற பொழுது உண்மையில் அது எந்த தொழிலாளியாக எந்த உத்தியோகத்தராக இருந்தாலும் கூட அவர்களிடம் இன்று வருகின்ற பொழுது அந்த காலையிலேயே அந்த விழிப்புணர்வு அந்த ஒரு 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 சந்தோஷமான சூழலிலே எங்களுடைய அந்த வாழ்க்கையை நாங்கள் தொடங்குகின்றோம். ஆகவே இத்தகைய சில அணுகுமுறைகள் உண்மையிலேயே ஒரு லீடராக அல்லது ஒரு மதராக எங்களுக்கு பல்வேறுபட்ட சந்தர்ப்பங்களை வாய்ப்புகளை தந்திருக்கிறது. உண்மையில் வடமாகாணத்திலே பல பல விதமான உத்தியோகத்தர்கள் காணப்பட்டாலும் கூட அவர்களுடைய அந்த அணுகுமுறைகள் சரியானதாக இருக்கின்ற பொழுது உண்மையில் எங்களுக்கு அவர்களுக்காக நாங்கள் கடமையாற்றுவதற்கான நிறைய சந்தர்ப்பங்கள் இருக்கின்றது. உண்மையில் போரால் பாதிக்கப்பட்டவர்கள் அல்லது வலுவிழந்தவர்கள் மாற்றுத்திறனாளிகள் என பல்வேறுபட்ட பெண் தலைமைத்துவ குடும்பங்கள் வாழ்கின்ற ஒரு மாகாணமாக எனது மாகாணம் காணப்படுகின்ற பொழுது உண்மையில் அவர்களுக்கான பல்வேறுபட்ட தொழில் வாய்ப்புகளை வழங்குகின்ற ஒரு சந்தர்ப்பமாக எனது திணைக்களம் அமைந்திருக்கின்றது. உண்மையில் நாங்கள் அவர்களுக்கு அந்த தலைமைத்துவ பண்புகளை ஆரம்பத்தில் இருந்து வழங்குகின்ற பொழுது உண்மையில் அவர்கள் ஒரு தங்களுடைய இந்த மாகாணத்திலே ஒரு மிளிர்கின்ற உதாரணமாக சொல்லக்கூடிய பல்வேறுபட்ட தொழில் முனைவோர்களாக இன்று காணப்படுகின்றார்கள். நான் நினைக்கிறேன் கொழும்பு வரைக்குமாக தங்களுடைய பொருட்களை ஏற்றுமதி செய்கின்ற அளவிற்கு அவர்களுடைய அந்த நடவடிக்கைகள் இன்று காணப்பட்டிருக்கின்றது. அவர்கள் உண்மையில் ஆரம்பத்திலே பல்வேறுபட்ட தொழில் முயற்சிகளுக்கு ஆரம்பிக்க பல்வேறுபட்ட பிரச்சனைகளை முகம் கொண்டுத்தாலும் கூட அவர்களுக்காக வழங்கப்படுகின்ற சில முயற்சிகளும் ஒத்துழைப்புகள் எல்லாம் அவர்கள் இன்று பல்வேறுபட்ட இன்று இந்த வருடம் கூட நாங்கள் உமன் எம்பவர்மெண்ட் என்பதன் ஊடாக உண்மையில் SIYB நீங்கள் அறிந்திருப்பீர்கள், ஸ்டார்ட் யுவர் பிசினஸ், இம்ப்ரூவ் யுவர் பிசினஸ் அண்ட் ஜெனரேட் யுவர் பிசினஸ் ஆக அந்த மூன்று உத்திகளின் ஊடாக பல்வேறுபட்ட தொழில் முனைவார்கள் உதாரணமாக அது பெண்களை நாங்கள் நோக்கி செய்கின்ற பொழுது கட்டாயம் அது அவர்களுக்கான ஒரு லீடர்ஷிப்பை எங்களுடைய மாகாணத்திலே வளர்க்கக்கூடியதாக இருக்கின்றது. அது அவர்களுடைய வாழ்க்கையை மெருகேற்றிக் கொண்டிருக்கிறது என்பதை நான் பெருமிதம் கொள்கின்றேன்.
Hierarchy, you need to be appreciative of the things people do, and as Ms. Vanaja very clearly mentioned, that you need to be smiling to make sure the rest of your employees or people who are working under you also maintain that and will reflect upon them as well. So as a leader, you need to be an example, is what Ms. Vanaja highlighted, and also she took us through the journey in the northern province as well, which is very, very inspiring to listen to. And we've come towards the final few minutes of the panel discussion as well, but I'd like to ask a question from all our panelists, and this is a take-home message for all the young aspiring women who wants to be entrepreneurs or more or less follow your pathway. So I'd start with Dr. Dilesha.
What I would like to say is start some, you know, if you think that you could be an entrepreneur, because it's not an easy path, you need to have a lot of self-confidence and self-motivation within you for you to succeed. So if you feel that you're such a character, you need to start something small. You know, if anything, we have to start small. So, and grow, work on that, grow as much as you can. That's what I would like to say, because we are a country where we need a lot of SMEs growing, because SME is the engine of the country. It, you know, contributes to about 52% of our GDP. So we need to increase the amount of entrepreneurs in the country, develop the entrepreneurs in the country. So I would like to say, start something small and work on that. That's the way that the country needs entrepreneurs. This is the most needed time for entrepreneurs. So I would like to say, request the people who has the capacity to become an entrepreneur to start something small. And if you feel that, you know, it's, if you're insecure or something, probably you can start working with someone and then, you know, earn something. And while you're working, you can develop your own thing, like a hybrid strategy. And subsequently, when you're a business is growing well, you can give up on your work, job, and then focus on your business.
It's kind that, of like having a plan A and B.
Exactly. Yeah, you need to have a plan A and B. So basically, you're secure because you have a job. Okay, you know, if something goes wrong, maybe that's a learning point. It's not a failure, but that's a learning point. That's how you should take it. That's the positivity that we need to building as entrepreneurs. And then, you know, then again, start something new, because, you know, the more you try, the more the experience that you gain. So basically, I would encourage the young generation, because they have a lot of innovative thinking. And they have a lot of opportunities, unlike, you know, us when we started at our young age. So start something small and work on that.
Thank you so much, Doctor. And we'd like to hear from Mrs. Hakim as well.
I want to add on to Dr. Leisha. My personal experience also has been to start small. That's why I said we need to grow incrementally, which is virtually what she also said. So we grow in steps and so on. And you need to maintain your positivity, maybe surround yourself with positive people. And then be what is very much needed is for you to be flexible with yourself, embrace flexibility. You be flexible with yourself. Okay, you can fall, you pick yourself up and go ahead. You don't give up. You know what I mean? I mean, it may sound cliche, but that's what I would like to
say. They say it's easier said than done.
Easier said than done. But nevertheless, it is a fact.
Exactly.
It is a fact. You've got to pick yourself up and go forward. And like she said, there are lots of opportunities now for the younger generation compared to our times. So, but only thing is, it's something that they will also be a little bit hesitant and fearful. But they shouldn't do that. They should have the courage to pick themselves up and go forward. Another thing I would advise is not to try to be a perfectionist. I know somewhere along the line I have also tried that. But you know, that really stresses you out. And that doesn't allow you to stretch and reach. So you need to love yourself, so to say, you know, and say, okay, I'm doing this right. This didn't go well. Right, I picked myself up and go forward. So you need to have that confidence. And also, again, I would reiterate about the support system. In my case, maybe from the generation I come from, that gives a lot of support, I'm sure. But of course, with the new way of doing things, like Dr. Delisha said, time management and segregation, all those things. With all that, this can be managed. But the young people need to come in, like she said. We need entrepreneurs, but at the same time, I would also encourage the state to assist them. You know, that is a bit lacking. It's quite lacking. I've had the personal experiences where they're not being, you know, assisted. They need a lot of assistance, microfinancing and so on. So I think there's a lot that the state can do to bring this talent out and to assist them. And like she said, I also agree that there should be a plan B. So like she says, maybe you have something going on parallelly to test the waters and then go forward. That's also one of the strategies.
Yeah. Thank you so much. And I'd also like to hear from Ms. Nadika. What would your message be to all the budding entrepreneurs?
රාජසේවයේ තියෙන වරප්‍රසාද විශේෂයෙන්ම නිවාඩු වැටුප් ඒ වගේම තියෙන අනිත් වරප්‍රසාද ගැන හිතලා විශ්‍රාම වැටුප මේ වගේ දේවල්. ඉතින් රාජ්‍ය සේවයට එකතු වෙන්න ඉන්න තරුණ පිරිසට මට දෙන්න තියෙන පණිවිඩය තමයි ඔබ රාජ්‍ය සේවයට එකතු වෙන්න. හැබැයි ඔබේ ආකල්පය විය යුත්තේ ඉතාමත් ධනාත්මකව අපේ රටේ මහජනතාවට සේවය කිරීමයි. විශේෂයෙන්ම රාජ්‍ය සේවයට එන්නේ මහජනතාවගෙන් වැටු ලබන පිරිසක් තමයි රාජ්‍ය සේවයේ ඉන්නේ. ඉතින් අපි රාජ්‍ය නිලධාරීන් විදිහට මේ තනතුරු අභිමානයක් විදිහට සැලකිය යුතු නැහැ. ඇත්තටම අපි සේවය සලසන්නේ අපේ රටේ මහජනතාවට. අපි ඔවුන්ගෙන් වැටුප් ලබනවා. ඒ වගේම අපි ඔවුන්ට කාර්යක්ෂම සේවයක් ඒ වෙනුවෙන් සැලසිය යුතුයි. ඉතින් මහජනතාව දිහා ධනාත්මකව බලලා අපේ රටට වඩාත් පුළුල් විශ්වාසනීය කාර්යක්ෂම සේවයක් සලසන අරමුණින් රාජ්‍ය සේවයට එකතු වෙන්න, ඒ වගේම විධායක ශ්‍රේණියකට එකතු වෙන්න බලාපොරොත්තු වෙන ඉන්න තරුණ පිරිස් ඔවුන් අනිවාර්යෙන්ම ඔවුන්ගේ උසස් අධ්‍යාපනය ඉතා කෙටි කාලයක් තුළ නිම කළ යුතුයි. මූලික උපාධිය, ඒ වගේම පශ්චාත් උපාධිය, විශේෂයෙන් ශ්‍රී ලංකා පරිපාලන සේවය වගේ ඕල් ඓලන්ඩ් සර්විසස් වලට ඇතුළත් වීමේදී ඊට සුවිශේෂී වූ සේවා ව්‍යවස්ථා සංග්‍රහයක් තියෙනවා. එහි සඳහන් වෙනවා මොනවද ඔබ ලබාගත යුතු සුදුසුකම් කියලා. ඒ වගේම වයස් සීමාවක් තියෙනවා. මේ වයස් සීමාවේදී අදාළ සුදුසුකම් සම්පූර්ණ කරලා ඉතාමත් තරඟකාරී විභාගයකට පෙනී සිටලා තමයි මේ සේවාවන් වලට ඇතුළු වෙන්න පුළුවන් වෙන්නේ. ඉතින් මේ සියලු දේවල් රාජ්‍ය පරිපාලන වෙබ්සයිට් එකේ ඇතුළත් වෙනවා. කැමැත්තෙන් ඉන්න තරුණ පිරිස් වලට පුළුවන් ඒ පිළිබඳව අදාළ වෙබ්සයිට් වලට යොමු වෙලා ඒ පිළිබඳව දැනුවත්භාවය ලබා ගන්න. ඒ වගේම රාජ්‍ය සේවයට සම්බන්ධ වෙන ඔබ ඇතුළත් වන මූලික තනතුරින් විශ්‍රාමය ආයුතු නැහැ. ඒ තුළ ඉතාමත් කැපවීමෙන් වැඩ කිරීම තුළ ඉදිරියට යන්න අවස්ථාව සැලසිලා තියෙනවා. ඒ අනුව රාජ්‍ය සේවයට එන්න ඒක ධනාත්මකව සිතලා රටට සේවයක් කරන අරමුණින්, ඒ වගේම තමුන්ගේ පෞද්ගලික ජීවිතය මවක් හෝ පියෙක් විදිහට ඒ කළ යුතු කැපකිරීම් ඉටු කරන ගමන් විශිෂ්ට වූ සේවාවක් සැලසීමේ අරමුණින් රාජ්‍ය සේවයට එකතු වෙන්න කියලා ආරාධනා කරනවා.
Mr. Ms. Nadika, and I'd also like to hear from Ms. Manager your message to aspiring entrepreneurs or people who want to get into the government sector.
Nandri, unmaile ஒன்றுபிரண்டாக இருப்பவர்களாக இருந்தாலும் சரி, அல்லது அலுவலர்களாக இருக்கின்றவர்களாக இருந்தாலும் சரி, உண்மையில் அவர்கள் ஏற்கனவே நான் கூறியது போன்று அவர்கள் விடாமுயற்சியும் அர்ப்பணிப்பான சேவையும் அவர்களுக்கு கட்டாயமான ஒன்றாக காணப்படுகின்றது. அதனை விட அவர்கள் உண்மையில் ஏற்கனவே மேடம் கூறினது போன்று கடந்த காலங்களை விட தற்போது பல்வேறுபட்ட வசதி வாய்ப்புகள் ஏற்பட்டிருக்கின்றது. ஆகவே அவற்றை நாங்கள் சரியான முறையிலே பயன்படுத்துவதற்கு, உதாரணமாக கடந்த 30 வருடங்களிலே சிறு தொழில் முயற்சியாளர்கள் என்று சொன்னால் அவர்கள் ஒரு மார்க்கெட்டில் போய்த்தான் அவர்கள் தங்களுடைய பொருட்களை விற்க வேண்டிய தேவை காணப்பட்டது. இன்று அது அப்படியே மாறி உண்மையில் இன்று ஆன்லைன் டிஜிட்டல் மார்க்கெட், அதாவது டிஜிட்டல் வேர்ல்ட்ல நாங்கள் டிராவல் பண்ணி கொண்டிருக்கிறோம். ஆகவே இது போன்ற பல்வேறுபட்ட சந்தர்ப்பங்களும் வாய்ப்புகளும் என்று அது சிறு தொழில் முயற்சியாளர்கள், அதாவது ஓண்டபிரண்டாக இருந்தாலும் சரி அல்லது அலுவலர்களாக இருந்தாலும் சரி, அவர்களுக்கு நோக்கி பல்வேறுபட்ட வாய்ப்புகளும் சந்தர்ப்பங்களும் அமைத்து கொடுக்கப்பட்டிருக்கிறதாகவே அவற்றை நாங்கள் சரியான முறையிலே பயன்படுத்துவதன் ஊடாக அவர்களை தங்களுடைய அந்த முயற்சிகளிலே மேலானவர்களாக கொண்டு வர முடியும். உதாரணமாக கற்கின்ற பிள்ளைகளில் இருந்து, உண்மையில் இலங்கையை பொறுத்தவரை இலவச கல்வி என்கின்ற ஒரு விடயம் நாங்கள் எங்களுக்கு கிடைத்திருக்கிற ஒரு வரப்பிரசாதம். ஆகவே அதனை நாங்கள் எவ்வாறு பயன்படுத்த வேண்டும் என்பதில் இருந்து ஆரம்பித்து உண்மையிலே ஒவ்வொரு கட்டத்திலுமே நாங்கள் சரியான முறையிலே நாங்கள் அவற்றை பயன்படுத்துவதன் ஊடாக நாங்கள் எல்லோருமே, அதாவது அலுவலர்களாக இருந்தாலும் சரி அல்லது சிறு தொழில் முயற்சியாளர்களாக இருந்தாலும் சரி, வசதி வாய்ப்புகளை தகுந்த முறையிலே பயன்படுத்துவதன் ஊடாக அவர்கள் தங்களுடைய வாழ்க்கையை மலிர செய்யலாம். உதாரணமாக சிறு தொழில் முயற்சியாளர்கள் நோக்கி நாங்கள் பல்வேறுபட்ட நிறுவனங்கள் பல்வேறுபட்ட தனியார் நிறுவனங்கள் என பல்வேறுபட்ட முயற்சிகள் எடுத்துக்கொண்டிருக்கிறோம். உண்மையில் அவர்களுடைய அந்த விடாமுயற்சியும் தன்னம்பிக்கையும் அர்ப்பணிப்பும் மேன்மேலும் அவர்களை வளர்க்க வேண்டும் என என்றும் அவர்களுக்கான அந்த எல்லாம் கிடைக்க வேண்டும் என்றும் இறைவனை பிரார்த்தித்து சந்தர்ப்பத்துக்கு நன்றி கூறுகின்றேன். நன்றி.
Thank you so much, Ramanandri. And I'd also like to hear from Oshadi.
So I think I would just echo basically everything that all these ladies have said. But I think fundamentally you have to remember that I'm speaking from a professional point of view because I'm not an entrepreneur like any of these ladies. But important to accept that you can't do it all. You have to acknowledge that you can't do it all. And the age-old saying of it takes a village to raise a child, it's very true because you do need a very good support system. And just basically that you need to pick and choose sometimes, and that's okay. So sometimes you need to let things go, and it's okay. You shouldn't beat yourself up about it, and you should just accept that and realize that the next best thing will come to you. And I think that's... Well, like Nadika said as well, you know, being a mother is only a blessing, and having a career and being able to have a mother, I can tell you, I mean, from experience, it comes with its own challenges, obviously. But believe in yourself, and sometimes don't worry about what everybody else says. Drown out all the noise and all the remarks, the judgments, and believe in yourself, because as long as you know what you want to do and where you want to go, and your kids are loved, end of the day, and they know that they're loved, I think you've won there. So sky is the limit.
I think that's the best way to put it. Love your kids and make sure they know that they're being loved as well. And with that, it's time for us to wrap things up in the panel discussion. But we did tell our viewers that the participants that they could pose some questions. So we have got a few questions. So we can accommodate a few because of time restrictions. So there's this very interesting question. So I guess it's best to ask this question from an entrepreneur who have co-founded a couple of companies, and I think even Mrs. Hakim falls under that category. So I just shoot this question so you could answer this. Please be kind enough to express your views on financial management as a working mother as well as an entrepreneur.
Financial management is very crucial when it comes to your business, your venture, because if you really don't effectively plan your financials, then you will not be able to have a like you're managing your working capital and etc. Then what you basically finance, your long term, your short term finances, everything matters when it comes to financial business. So it is very important that you look at your financial aspect and understand the priorities and allocate accordingly and manage your working capital. And also as an entrepreneur, because you have the access to company funds, you should not misuse the company funds, because end of the day then your venture will be collapse. So financial management is a very crucial aspect in a business.
Do you wish to add to that?
Yes,
as well?
Of course, I agree with that too. You need to segregate the business from yourself or yes. from your private existence. That's absolutely essential. So like you said, you need to keep your finance. I think that's basically it. You need to keep your finances separate, and of course have very prudent management even within the organization.
Exactly.
So I would say that you can delegate as opposed to a large extent, but this is some area where you have to have your finger
yes.
on.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank
yes.
you so much for that amazing question, Fatima Mubashira. And we have a question for Mrs. Vanaja as well. How do you see the support of the male counterparts to respect a remarkable leadership shown by ladies like you? This question is by Vagesh Punnambalam. Mrs. Vanaja.
Oh, Nandri. உண்மையிலே இதில் ஆண்கள் சம்பந்தமான பங்களிப்பு அல்லது ஒத்துழைப்பு என்பது ஒரு தலைமைத்துவமான பெண்களுக்கு எவ்வாறு அமையும் என்பதாக அந்த கேள்வி அமைகின்றது என நினைக்கின்றேன். உண்மையிலே அது குடும்பத்தில் இருந்தாலும் சரி அல்லது அலுவலகமாக இருந்தாலும் சரி, அவர்களுடைய ஒத்துழைப்பும் பங்களிப்பும் இருக்கின்ற பொழுதுதான் லீடர்ஷிப் எப்பவுமே வெற்றி பெறுவதாக அமையும் என நினைக்கின்றேன். உண்மையிலே அது குடும்பத்திலே இருக்கின்ற பொழுது கணவனுடைய ஒத்துழைப்பு என்பது எங்களுக்கு மிக மிக வேண்டிய ஒரு விடயமாக இருக்கின்றது. ஆகவே அதிலிருந்து அந்த தலைமைத்துவத்திற்கான பங்களிப்பு என்பது, அது ஆண் சார்ந்த பங்களிப்பு என்பது அதிலே ஆரம்பிக்கின்றது. அதனை போன்று அலுவலகங்களிலே உண்மையிலே சில விடயங்கள், அதாவது எங்களுடைய பெண்கள் சார்ந்த சில விடயங்களிலே ஆண்களுடைய அந்த அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்டிங், விளங்கி கொள்கின்ற தன்மை என்பது மிகவும் முக்கியமான விடயமாக காணப்படுகின்றது. அதனை விட பெண்களால் முடியும் என்கின்ற அந்த விடயத்திலே ஆண்கள் எவ்வாறு ஒத்துழைக்கின்றார்கள் என்பது அங்கே முக்கியமான விடயமாக காணப்படுகின்றது. ஆகவே பங்களிப்பு என்பது தலைமைத்துவமான ஒரு பெண்ணின் பின்னால் ஒரு ஆணின் பங்களிப்பும் ஒத்துழைப்பும் இருப்பது என்பது உண்மையிலே ஒரு முக்கியமான விடயமாக காணப்படுகின்றது. ஆகவே அந்த ஒத்துழைப்பும் பங்களிப்பும் அல்லது அவர்களுடைய அந்த நான் ஏற்கனவே கூறியது போன்ற அந்த பாராட்டுதல்கள் என்பது என்பது உண்மையிலே அந்த மற்ற பார்ட், அதாவது அவர்களிடமிருந்து கிடைக்கின்ற பொழுது அது டபுளாக, அதாவது இரட்டிப்பாக என்ற தன்மைகள் காணப்படுகின்றது. ஆகவே ஒரு தலைமைத்துவம் கொண்ட ஒரு பெண்ணின் பின்னால் ஒத்துழைப்பு உள்ள ஒரு ஆண்களினுடைய பங்களிப்பு என்பது மேலானதாக காணப்படுகின்றது. அது இல்லாமல் போகின்ற சந்தர்ப்பத்தில் கட்டாயம் அங்கே ஒரு நெகிழ்வுத்தன்மை காணப்பட வாய்ப்பு இருக்கின்றது. ஆகவே அது இல்லாவிடில் இங்கு இல்லை என்பது அதற்கான அர்த்தம் இல்லை, ஆனால் அது இருக்கின்ற பொழுது இன்னும் மேலானதாக காணப்படும் என்கின்றது எனது கருத்தாக காணப்படுகின்றது.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And we have a question for Ms. Damayanti. And this is about asking, this question is from Kumudu. Do you get foreign exposure as a government officer? If yes, how do you manage your family in those crucial times? And yeah, that would be your question by Kumudu.
මට විදේශ පුහුණු වීම වගේම විදේශ සංචාර වලට අවස්ථාව ලැබිලා තියෙනවා. ඉන්දියාව, මැලේසියාව, නේපාලය, ඒ වගේම චීනය, නව සීලන්තය වගේ රටවල් වල සංචාරය කරන්න ඒ තුලින් මට අවස්ථාව ලැබුණා. ඇත්තටම වැදගත්ම දේ තමයි මට ඉතාමත් ආදරණීය පවුලක් ලැබිලා තියෙනවා. මගේ පවුලේ සමාජිකයන් විශේෂයෙන්ම මගේ අම්මා තාත්තා ඒ වගේම මගේ සහෝදරියන් දෙදෙනා, මගේ දරුවන්, මගේ ස්වාමි පුරුෂයා, මේ සියලුම දෙනා එක්ක පුදුම ආදරණීය බැඳීමක් තියෙනවා. ඉතින් ඇත්තටම මම හිතන්නේ ඒක මම ලැබපු වාසනාවක්. නිවසේ වැඩ කටයුතු කරගන්න අය විමසන විදිහට මට මෙහෙකරුවන් නැහැ. ඉතින් අපි සියලුම දෙනා එකතු වෙලා තමයි නිවසේ කටයුතු කරගන්නේ. ඒ වගේම මම විදේශගත වෙන අවස්ථාවල කලින් සියලුම දේ පුළුවන් උපරිමයෙන් සැලසුම් කරනවා. ඒ වගේම මගේ අම්මා, මගේ සහෝදරියන් දෙදෙනා නිරන්තරයෙන් මගේ දරුවන්ට ආරක්ෂාව සපයනවා මම ලංකාවේ නැති කාල සීමාවෙදී. ඒ වගේම මට බොහොම තරුණ පුතෙක් ඉන්නවා. ඇත්තටම ආඩම්බරයි කියන්න, ඔහු හරිම විනයගරුක විදිහට සාරධර්මයක හැදුණු පුතෙක්. ඉතින් නිරන්තරයෙන් ඔහු තමන්ගේ නැගෙනයන් දෙදෙනාව ආරක්ෂා කරගනිමින් නිවසේ කටයුතු වගේම ඔහුගේ අධ්‍යාපන කටයුතු, උසස් අධ්‍යාපන කටයුතු, මේ සියලු දේවල් වල නිරත වෙනවා. ඉතින් මේ විදිහට තමයි මම විදේශගත වෙලා ඉන්න අවස්ථාවල මගේ පවුල දේවල් බැලන්ස් කරගන්නේ. ස්තුතියි මේ ප්‍රශ්නේ යොමු කරාට කුමුදු.
And we've also got another question. How can one effectively demonstrate their husbands of being committed to both professional responsibilities and being a dedicated mother? And we could ask that from any of the panelists who is here, because they have not directed it at any specific panelist. So how can one effectively demonstrate their husbands of being committed to both professional responsibilities and being a dedicated mother?
To demonstrate to their husbands.
Yes. That's what the question says.
I see.
Effectively demonstrate to their husbands that you're playing both
well,
roles
well. You have
well.
To get the buy-in from your husband, the support, family support you as entrepreneur. Mm. So it is vital because they need to understand our role as a mother, as an entrepreneur, and they really need to support us in terms of
and support system.
Support system. If we don't have the support, we wouldn't have been successful, you know, as today. So, you know, we as entrepreneurs, we've been able to convince our family members and to get their support to to come up to this level. So it is a vital part as an entrepreneur that you get the buy-in from your family to be successful in
particularly your spouse.
Yes, exactly. Yes, they need to be able to understand us and, you know, to support us. That's a vital part.
Exactly. So
there should be no conflicts.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the only way we can go forward.
Yeah, that's right.
With stress-free and with support and be encouraged.
Yes, very true. And I think we heard a lot from Ms. Nadika and also from Ms. Vanaja about her experience, and also from the government sector. And then we had a very diverse panel who gave us an insight into the corporate world and being an entrepreneur with flexi hours to how you work 24 hours on call duty. So this is an amazing platform where we got to learn and understand about the balance of work life and also family, and, you know, showing love, nurturing, and having me time, which is important. So there are more questions directed, and I'm pretty sure that this will be answered later on because of the time, and we'll have to wrap things up at the moment. But we do have a few appreciation messages, and they say this is a very nice experience because she's a young mother working in a company. And she would like to thank all the panelists, and I didn't get the name here. So she'd like to thank all the panelists for sharing their experiences. And she also says that it has been quite a great journey listening to all of you. And also they would like to wish all the women who are inspiring us, especially Mrs. Vanaja. And there's also a compliment saying you're truly the most inspiring person I have ever met. And I'd like to thank all the panelists for making this a very interesting, inspiring, and informative panel discussion, because we definitely learned a lot in terms of financial management, then again, time management, organizing and planning, and also you need to have education background. At the same time, adapt to technology, have the willpower, and about leadership qualities and to be a good listener. So that's kind of, in my perspective, what I've gathered out of this panel discussion. And not every mother and every working mother has the same role to play. It's a different role depending on the profession you've selected, the path you've selected. So it has been quite a journey talking to everybody. It has been amazing. So once again, I'd like to thank all our panelists for being a part of this amazing panel discussion. Thank you so much.
Thank you, thank you very much. Thank you. It's a pleasure to being here.
Thank you so much for Mrs. Vanaja.
It has been wonderful for us to be here.
Yes.
I know, including the ladies who joined us online and gave us their insights.
Exactly.
It has been a very, for us also, very insightful
sharing experiences, knowledge, and very informative.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And once again, I'd like to thank all the participants as well for being very attentive and for sharing their questions with us. And we couldn't take every single question which we've got, but we'll make it a point to maybe answer them privately. And since it's in the chat box, we could do the needful for you. Thank you so much.
And maybe we can have another
another panel discussion. Exactly. So it has been very interesting talking to these amazing ladies today, and it's a very fruitful panel discussion, I'd say. So with that, it's time for me to sign off and hand over to Amra Minza, who will be proposing the vote of thanks. Right, ladies and gentlemen, as we conclude this enriching panel discussion on exploring the vital role of mothers in leadership and strategies for balancing work, family, and life, I would like to take this moment to extend our deepest gratitude to everyone who has made this event a success. And I'm Amra Minzar, your Assistant Secretary to the Board of Management of RPSL Consortium. To begin with, we warmly acknowledge the support and encouragement of our President, Mr. Shabri Halimdin, being a great source of motivation to our team. We would like to extend our deepest gratitude to Mr. Saif Hanifa, our patron, Vice President, and more or less, as we all call, the father of RPSL, for his unwavering contribution and dedication. His steadfast commitment has been instrumental in sustaining the momentum of RPSL, relentlessly driving its mission forward for the greater benefit of the community. His leadership has motivated and driven many successful initiatives from both senior and junior members of the RPSL. The members of the Board of Management, including the Vice President, Mr. Wazir Marikar, and the Secretary General and the Senior Lecturer of the University of Colombo, Dr. Shamila Dawood, and to all the Board of Management members of RPSL. Further, we extend our heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Ali Ahlam Nawaz, the member of the Board of Management and the country head of Malaysia and Singapore, the Hot Pack Packaging. Dr. Ali, the architect and backbone of this project. Without his unwavering commitment and leadership, and despite his busy working schedule and professional responsibilities, this project would not have seen the light of the day. Dr. Ali has consistently provided extensive support in upholding the objectives of our forum, offering invaluable advice, and even coordinating the whole event remotely with us to support the initiatives of RPSL Consortium. And further, to our project chairman, member of the Board of Management, Vice President of the Secretary General, and our distinguished panelist, Mrs. Shahnaz Hakim, who has been the key in driving this event and coordinating this panel discussion with us today. Her unwavering attention to detail ensured that this event is well executed. Mrs. Hakim, an exceptional individual, effortlessly balancing her professional responsibilities, family life, and her dedication to serving the community and society. We deeply appreciate her outstanding performance and leadership, ma'am.
Thank you, my pleasure.
Most importantly, a special note of thanks to Mr. Misbar Makin, the Managing Director of Mandarina Hotels, by whose courteously and generosity we were able to hold this discussion at this prestigious event. Mr. Dinesh Hetiarachi, the General Manager, and Mr. Angelo Jason Nathan, the Food and Beverage Manager, and the hotel staff of Mandarina Hotels, for their excellent on-site arrangements, vouching for this extra special customer care and hospitality. Further, we cannot go away without this wonderful, stellar panelist we had with us today, Dr. Dilisha Pereira, Ms. Oshadi Somasingha Karunaratna, Ms. Nadika Damayanti, Ms. Vanaja Selvaratnan, and Ms. Shahnaz Hakim. We really appreciate our panelists who even joined us virtually online amidst having this hybrid system. So we really appreciate your presence and contribution to this particular event. It has truly been invaluable. The insights and experiences you shared with us not only highlighted the critical role that mothers play in leadership, but also offered us a more practical strategies of how we can achieve balance in such multifaceted lives. Your perspectives have enriched our understanding and will undoubtedly inspire many to navigate these challenges with greater confidence and clarity. And to all our participants who've joined us this evening, I would like to express our appreciation with your encouragement, thoughtful questions, and active participation has made it crucial in making this event more interactive and meaningful. Further, to our organizing committee and everyone working behind the scenes, thank you for your dedication and effort to bringing this event to a success. Your hard work does not go unnoticed, and it has contributed immensely for this event. Our sincere appreciation to our PR team, who has handled our social media pages, and the technical team. Mr. Shiraz Fauz, the president of the Working Committee Group, and our secretary for the Working Committee Group, Ms. Muska Naja. We appreciate the Her Highness organization and Ms. Hajra Yasir for posting promotional videos in targeting respective platforms to have a diverse audience. Further, not forgetting the invaluable contribution made by the event management led by Ms. Kaushalya and her team, and Mr. Imran Tahir, who coordinated the event to perfection and success, providing audio, visual, and the technical support to Puppets Private Limited, as well as collaborating very closely with Mrs. Hakim and the panelists today. Ms. Kaushalya, a truly professional individual who is an integral part of this project, juggling with her busy schedules and professional commitments. We truly thank you, Ms. Kaushalya. Last and certainly not the least, we do acknowledge with great gratitude and appreciation to our very own moderator, Ms. Sharifa Tahir, an award-winning TV and radio representer, news anchor, and journalist. Ms. Sharifa readily agreed to be a pivotal presence for this discussion, lending her expertise despite her busy schedules and multiple roles in her colorful personality to this particular event and ensuring success. Now let's carry forward with the insights and inspirations that we gathered here today, championing the incredible roles that mothers play both in their personal and professional lives. We look forward to welcoming you to our future endeavors, and we are pleased to share that we have the recorded version of this video, which can be shared amongst your family and friends post this event. Thank you all for being a part of this wonderful and important and very crucial topic that we all deserve to know today. Safe travels to our panelists here today, and we look forward to future gatherings. Thank you very much. Hope you all have a great evening.